Good afternoon, dear children. How are you all? Yes, you all are. I hope you all are excellent and safe at home. We'll continue our last lecture, that is from Beehive, lesson number 7, Packing, written by Jerome K. Jerome. In the last lecture, we have seen short summary of this lesson. Now we are going to be learn the detailed explanation, passage wise explanation in this lecture. What is so packing, written by Jerome K. Jerome. Now here this lesson has taken from the novel Three Men in a Boat. Means all these three men, which are the three men, okay, who are the characters, which are the characters in this lesson? The one character is Jerome, the narrator. In this lesson, narrator itself means the writer in himself is telling story about very humorous story, and he is the first character, that is Jerome. Second, his two friends, that is Harris and George, and third one is a pet dog is with them, that is a Montmorency. These four characters are there in this lesson. So this lesson has taken from a novel, that is Three Men in a Boat. Very humorous story. So we'll see. Okay, we'll see now about author, that is Jerome K. Jerome. Jerome Kalpaka Jerome. K means it's a Kalpaka. Jerome was born on May 2nd, 1859 in Caldmore, Walsall, England. He obtained his school education at St. Mary Leybourne Grammar School, London. He was an English writer and a humorist. He is best known for the comic Traveller. Traveller means always writes on a travel, you know, story on travel. Traveller. Three Men in a Boat. Apart from this, he wrote some essays collections with Idle Thoughts of an Idle Fellow. Idle Thoughts of an Idle Fellow. Second, Thoughts of an Idle Fellow, The Three Men on the Bermail, and some other novels. He breathed his last on June 14, 1927. Jerome's father died when he was only 13 years old, and his mother died when he was 15. He was brought up in a poverty in London. Jerome wished to enter politics or to be a man of letters, but the death of his parents forced him to quit his studies because early age only his parents died. Quit studies and find work to support himself. This is a short information about our writer, that is Jerome K. Jerome. So we'll go to our lesson. We'll see lesson. Now the first paragraph. This lesson, as I said, it's a narration. Who is telling, who is narrating this story? Jerome K. Jerome means the writer of this packing, or writer of this lesson. I said I would pack. I rather pride myself on my packing. Packing is one of those many things that I feel I know more about than any other person living. It surprises me myself sometimes how many such things there are. I impressed the fact upon George and Harris and told them that they had better leave the whole matter entirely to me. They fell into a suggestion with a readiness that had something uncanny. Uncanny means, you know, strange. Okay, now strange, uncanny, About it, George spread himself over the easy chair and Harry's cocked tilted. You know, that is a tilted. We can say that is a tilted. Harris cocked his leg on the table. As in, what is there in the first paragraph? First paragraph, Jerome said, he boasted that I have a skill, very good skill to pack. So you take a rest and I will pack bags. So these two friends, George and Harry, said, okay, now you do your work. And as he said that I will pack, they relaxed on the chair and sat very simply. Means they were not helping anything and sitting very simply, okay, on easy chair, and some others were sitting. Harry's cock tilted his legs on the table in this way. What is second paragraph? This was hardly what intended. What I had mean, of course, was that I should boss the job and that Harris and George should potter about under my direction. I pushing them aside every now and then with, oh, you here, let me do it. They are simple enough, really touching them, as you might say. They are taking it in the way they did irritated me. There is nothing does irritate me more than seeing other people sitting about doing nothing when I am working. In the second paragraph, the narrator narrates that actually I mean to say that I am very, he want to escape from that. And he was thinking, if I say that, okay, I am very skilled, I have a skill to pack the bags, means I can supervise them. And his intention was that only. They will do and he will supervise. But these two friend circles misunderstood him and he started. Now Jerome itself, narrator itself, started packing. But when narrator was packing back and these two were simply sitting, it irritates narrator. He said that it irritates me. Mujhe kafi gussa aaya when they were sitting simply. I too sometimes feel at home, you know. If I am doing alone work and others are sitting simply and watching TV and doing all the works, so it irritates me. It's a human nature. So Jerome, the narrator, also felt the same thing. What is in the third paragraph? I lived with a man once who used to make me mad that way. He would loll on the sofa and watch me doing things by the hour together. He said it did him real good to look on at me messing about. Now I am not like that. I can't sit still and see another man slaving and working. I want to get up and superintend and walk around with my hands in my pockets and tell him what to do. It is my energetic nature. I can't help it. What it is saying? I lived with a man once he used to see slaving. I don't like that others are slaving. Slaving means doing all the work together. Instead of that, I have that habit to put hands, you know, and supervise them what the others are doing. Next, however, I did not say anything but started the packing. He did not say anything and quietly he started packing his bag. It seemed a longer job than I had thought it was going to be, but I got the bag finished at last and I sat on it and strapped it. What it is written there? He packed his bag and completed and strapped it. Aren't you going to put the boots in? Said Harris. Harris, then he was aside beside him. Then he said, have you kept my boots in? And I looked around and found I have forgotten them. Then Harris asked him, "Have you kept our boots inside?" Then he had seen around. Then he saw that boot was outside only, not in the bag. Forgotten them. That just like Harris. He couldn't have said a word until I would got the bag shut and strapped. Of course. And George laughed. One of those irritating. Then he said that, "Why you don't tell me before I pack my bag? You should have told me that my boots are outside. I could have kept inside." Then the George laughed. "Ah, this is your packing. So you said that I have that skill. I'm very good in packing. Then what happened?" So he laughed. And when he laughed, it got irritated again to our narrator. Irritating, senseless laugh of his. "They do make me so wild." So again, irritating. These two friend circles irritating Jerome, writer. "I opened the bag and packed the boots in. And then just I was going to close it. Then again he took, then anyhow he has to open. So he opened and kept inside that boot that he kept inside. And as he was going to close it, a horrible idea occurred to me. Had I packed my toothbrush? I don't know how it is, but I never do know whether I have packed my toothbrush. He remembered whether I have packed my toothbrush. He has not remembering that whether he has kept or not. My toothbrush is a thing that haunts me when I am traveling. This is always happens that whenever the tooth means we want to search whether we had keep or not, and if I had kept, we have to find that where it is that whenever we need it. So my toothbrush is a thing that haunts me when I am traveling and makes my life a misery. I dream that I haven't packed it and wake up in a cold perspiration and get out of bed and hunt for it. And in the morning, I pack it before I have used it and have to unpack again to get it. And it is always the last thing I turn out the bag and then I repack and forget it and have to rush upstairs for it at last moment and carry it to the railway station wrapped up in my pocket handkerchief. See ya." If the narrator tells that whenever we go for a trip, whenever I pack my bag, I always one day before I keep that, and the next day when I need, again I reopen the bag, again I use it, and again I forgot. I keep outside only, and whenever I need, I remember that in the relation area I have not packed my toothbrush. Again, I have to go and purchase that and do this. This toothbrush, small toothbrush, makes me haunt. Now, haunting means what is there here, little? Haunt, to keep coming back to the mind of someone to make him sad. That toothbrush is like haunting me always, that because of that, I have to go. It makes me misery, makes me sad. What it is written? "Of course, I had to turn every mortal things out now, and of course, I could not find it. I remerged the things up into much the same state that they must have been before the world was created. For this, he has to take out all the things again, and when chaos reigned." Again, chaos means up and down, all the things are mess. "Of course, I found George and Harris 18 times over, but I couldn't find my own. I couldn't find my own brush. I put the things back one by one and held everything up and shook it. Then I found it inside the board. I repacked once again. See the small brush. When we are keeping, brush is like this only. When we are keeping, we have to be very careful. So he was not remembering. He could find the others too, but he couldn't find. So he has whatever he has packed inside. Again, he took out and all was shook all the clothes like this. And he saw that. And after at last, he got that his brush in the into boot. So he had packed, again the chaos happened, and again all the things was missed, and again he packed all the things. See, this lesson is only the humorous story, how the packing was going on. Repacked once more. What is in the seventh paragraph? When I had finished, George asked if the soap was in. Soap, bathing soap. Then Harris asked. Then see, they could have told all the things to him, but it was a very humorous, funny what they have written, they have given for us. I said, I didn't care a hang whether the soap was in or whether it wasn't. Now I won't care for this. And I slammed the bag shut and strapped it. I slammed, packed the bag, I closed that and found that I had packed my spectacles in it and had to reopen it. Spectacles, he wanted that spectacles, all the things, spectacles he kept inside. How can we keep our spectacles? Spectacles we need always. Then again for that, he has to reopen that bag. It got shut up finally at 10:05 p.m. And then there remained the hampers to do. Harry said that we should be wanting to start in less than 12 hours time and thought that he and George had better to do the rest. And I agreed and sat down and they had a go. Then he was fed up. Then Harris and George said, okay, now you don't do the rest things, we will pack and we will do. Then the narrator sat beside a side. Okay, they began in a light-hearted spirit, evidently intending to show me how to do it. I made no comment. They were doing very slowly, but now the narrator was tired of, fed up with the packing, so he did not comment when they both were packing bag. I only waited. With the exception of George, Harris is the worst packer in the world. He is thinking in his mind that. And I looked at the piles of plates and cups and kettles and bottles and jars and pies and stoves and cakes and tomatoes, etc. All the things were there because their journey, it was in the boat. So stove also they must carry because it takes much time, many days to reach the other place. So they have to carry all these things, eatable things. So all the, what is this, you know, pies, eating things, P-I-E-S, means all the eatable things they have to keep in a basket. All the things, it did started with I felt that the thing would soon become exciting. It did. They started with breaking a cup. See, they were worst. Actually, he was not also, Jerome was also not good. But they were actually, Jerome was a bad packer. And they were the worst, you know. So first of all, they break a cup. That was the first thing they did. They did that just to show you what they could do and to get you interested. Then Harris packed the strawberry jam on top of a tomato and squashed it. See, on tomato, he packed strawberry jam. Jam, the bottle and all the tomatoes squashed it, and they had to pick out the tomato with teaspoon. When they see the packing, how they are, first they had kept the tomato and then the squash bottles and all. And because of that, this also make us like a squash, you know, completely spoiled. So they have to take out tomato with a teaspoon. And then it was Joe's turn, and he trod means stepped on. Then he started packing back, trod on the butter. And I didn't say anything, but I came over and sat on the edge of the table and watched them. Narrator is saying, now Harry started packing bag, and he started packing with the butter and all. It irritated them more than anything I could have said. I felt that it made them nervous and excited, and they stepped on things and put things behind them and then couldn't find them when they wanted them. And they packed the pies at the bottom and put heavy things on top and smashed the pies in. All the eatable items they kept inside first, and the other things they kept on the top of that. Whatever the eatable items were, they are completely spoiled, smashed it. They upset salt over everything. And as for the butter, I never saw two men do more one and two pence worth of butter in my whole life than they did. After George had got it off his slipper, they tried to put it in a kettle. It wouldn't go in, and what was in wouldn't come out. They did scrap out at last and put it down on a chair, and Harry sat on it and it stuck to him, and they went looking for it all over the room. See, the thing is, what is that? The butter whole life than they had did. Okay, it wouldn't go in and was in the couldn't came out. They did scrap it out at last and put it down on the chair. All the eatable items they took, it was spoiled, and they kept on the chair, and the same he George sat on that, and it was stuck on back of him. And the same thing they were searching everywhere. I will take my oath, I put it down on that chair, said George, staring at the empty seat. I saw you do it myself not a minute ago, said Harris. Then they started round the room again looking for it, and then they met again in a center and started at one another. Most extraordinary thing I ever heard of, said George. So mysterious, said Harris. Then George got round at the back of Harris and saw it. Then they found that it is stuck backside of him. Then saw it. Why, here it is all the time, he exclaimed indignantly. Where? Cried Harris, spinning around. Stand still, can't you? Roared George, flying after him. You wait, it is there only. And they got it off and packed it in the teapot. Montmorency was it in it all, the pet dog. Of course, Montmorency, the ambition in life is to get in the way and be sworn at to mess all the things. Life is get away and sworn it. If he can swim in anywhere where he particularly is not wanted and be a perfect nonsense and make people mad and have the things thrown at his head, then he feels his day was not being wasted. To get somebody to stumble over him and curse him steadily for an hour is his highest aim and object, and when he has succeeded in accomplishing this, his conceit becomes quite unbearable. He came and sat down on things. Who? The pet dogs. He unpacked the bag, so where all the things were there, and he sat, the pet dog sat on eat, just when they were wanted to be packed. And he labored under the fixed belief that whenever Harry's or George reached out their hand for anything, it was his cold damp nose that they wanted. He put his leg into the jam and he disturbed the teaspoons and he pretended that the lemons were rats and got into the hamper and killed three of them before Harry's could land him with the flying pan. See, actually they all were fed up with that, and in that the Montmorency, the pet dog, was disturbing them, and he was back of that Montmorency with the big pan. By that time he spoiled those things which were kept down. Harry said, I encouraged him. I didn't encourage him. A dog like that doesn't want any encouragement. It's the nature. Then Harry said, you are encouraging. So he said, no, I have not encouraged anyone, because the dog's nature is like that, to play with like this. Original sin that is born in him that makes him do things like that. The packing was in hook and crook, you know, in anyhow they have packed the bags. Not only the narrator, but narrator, George, Harry's, all the three people, they have anyhow they packed their bags at 12:50, and Harry sat on the big hamper and said he hoped nothing would be found broken. He packed back and he kept, and I'm again saying ki, now nothing, what is there? Nothing would be found broken. George said that if anything was broken, it was broken, which reflection seemed to comfort him. He also said he was ready for bed. We were all ready for bed. Harry was to sleep with us that night, and we went upstairs. We tossed for bed and Harry's had to sleep with me, he said, as they have packed all the things. So both slept together, and one without bed he slept. Do you prefer the inside or outside, Jay? I said, I generally prefer to sleep inside the bed. Harry said it was odd. George said, what time shall I wake you up, fellows? Harry said, 7. I said, no, 6, because I wanted to write some letter. Harry's and I had a bit of a row over it, but at last split the difference and said 6:30. Wake us at 6:30, George, we said. George made no answer, and we found on going over that we had been asleep for some time. So we placed the bath where he could tumble into it on getting out in the morning, and went to bed ourselves. So this is a humorous story, and they have given the story in a very humorous form. So written by Jerome K. Jerome. I hope, dear children, you have understood this lesson. Still, you read this lesson once again very carefully and try to understand the story. Thank you and have a nice day.